This is Jeff Durbin with Apologia Radio talking to you about realharmony.org. The profanation of marriage is gaining legs within our culture with the homosexual marriage issue. This is, in fact, church, a gospel issue. We must be salt, a preservative. We have to be light on this issue of homosexual marriage, and we do that at realharmony.org.
This is Joy Temby with Apologia Radio, and you guys, it is so important that you pray for a burden for the people in the homosexual community. Then go to realharmony.org and check out the resources we provide to equip Christians on this issue.
This is the Ministry Bear. Here's the issue. The culture has a universal symbol that recognizes homosexual gay marriage. It's an equal sign. You see it everywhere. Until now, the Christian community has not had a symbol that you look at and say, that's harmonious, real, biblical marriage. Go to realharmony.org. Buy a sticker. They're $3 a piece. Get your church to buy and buy the truckloads. We have a goal of selling a million of them and getting this out to the culture. Church, jump on it. Realharmony.org.
I would say if the authorities didn't want us involved in the public square, they ought not to have crucified Jesus in the public square.
Use humanistic principles.
Well, I would say
the same idea.
I would say
same
end. I would say, what's the problem with stardust bumping into stardust?
In the cosmic picture, no, there's no problem. In the cosmic picture, it won't matter.
No, Mr. President, you are not protecting reproductive freedom. You are authorizing the destruction of freedom for 1 million little human beings every year.
I'm sorry, my friends, but I am tired of seeing Jesus presented as a weak beggar. He is a powerful Savior, and the gospel is not a suggestion, it is a command.
Reverend Mola, don't you sympathize with that?
I sympathize with every single human heart wishing to know the one true and living God, but I believe there's only one way that that can happen, through Jesus Christ, and the gospel is about repenting of sin, not celebrating it.
Adventure. We will explore the spiritual abyss. You have not experienced this before. You're gonna love it.
What's up, y'all? This is the gospel heard around the world. Apologia Radio. Coming at you from 1360 KPXQ. Faith Talk, Phoenix, baby. Hey, get us on iTunes. You can go and Apologia Radio, subscribe to it, get all the past episodes. Also, go to our Facebook page, like us on Facebook, get all the episodes. You can share them with your friends, family, and brosifs. Deliver them to everyone you know. Let's get the gospel into the culture and bring glory and exaltation to Christ. I'm in the studio today with Joy Temby.
Hello.
You see, I have like a pattern now. Mm-hmm. I'm going to you first.
Yep.
And then I'll move over to this guy over here.
Mm-hmm.
So what's up, Joy? How you feeling?
I'm pretty good.
Yeah, you look a little tired today. Be honest.
I'm a little tired today.
Yeah, you were about to fall asleep right there during John Piper.
Yep.
I saw it.
Not because he's boring, but because I'm just tired.
I got a little cattle prod under the table. I'm just going to poke you with it if you... Okay?
Thank
Stay
you.
With us. Stay with
for
us.
That.
Also, we have over here another man wearing... Do you have your delicious beard on? I mean, you clearly have a delicious beard on, but do you have the delicious beard balm on?
Of course. Absolutely.
And it smells?
Glorious.
Glorious. Actually, he brought it over. This tells you how ridiculous we are. We went out the other night. We actually had dinner with Gary DeMar.
Uncle Gary.
Uncle mm-hmm. Gary DeMar. We go out to have dinner with Gary DeMar. And on the way, he makes sure to bring his little tin of delicious beard balm. And it's orange and cedarwood. And I must confess, it does smell better than mine, which is orange, bacon, and cloves, and Sprite.
Right.
Yours smells like Christmas.
It does. It really does. Hey, you know how you usually have like an opening clip for yourself?
Yeah.
Did you have one today?
I couldn't get it to work.
Okay, but I have one for you.
Oh, great.
I prepared one for you. No, it's a good thing.
Oh, okay, okay.
You see, this hurts my feelings.
Your feelings?
You think I have something up my sleeve? I don't.
You don't have any sleeves on. Okay, let's go.
With Joel, you were going to say
I actually have a question for you.
Okay,
really
okay. Oh, hold on now. Let me get ready. Go. Lay it on me. Let's go.
Okay, so you guys have...
Yes, I like bacon.
This is a really, really weird thought, but welcome to my brain.
Okay.
So you guys have these smells and tastes that you prefer. Mm-hmm. Do you think that your beards have their preferred smells and tastes as well? Like, is there a food that your beard would prefer you get caught in it?
Bacon.
Bacon.
Yeah.
Bacon.
How do you know that?
Bacon, any kind of meat. So, okay, the other night we went out to, it's called Fuga de Chao.
Fogo de Chao.
Fogo de Chao. It's like a Brazilian meat fest. It's a meat fest. You were there. I mean, my goodness. I felt so terrible, by the way. Joy doesn't eat meat. And here I am, like, let's go take Gary DeMar to Meat Fest 2013. It's like they bring, like, meat on swords, and they just keep continually slicing off meat. My beard was thanking me all night for that. Yeah. As a matter of fact, I haven't washed it since. It smells of sirloin and ribeye.
I didn't mind the meat, but I did want to eat some food off of swords, and I didn't get to.
They come by because they feel sorry for you, and they just have like pieces of celery on a sword. Yep. Like, here you go.
Some cabbage.
Slice off.
All right. And, okay, hold on. And off track right away. Okay.
I'm sorry.
All right, here we go. So this is Luke Pearson, and this is how I feel about you. I think you're freaky, and I like you a
lot. Oh my gosh, that video. The music video.
Scary. Be careful watching
it. It's straight up demonic.
It's scary looking. Yeah, it's weird. The song is interesting, but yeah. All right, hey, we got to get to the episode because this is going to be killer, amazing. Hey, guys, you know on the show, Apologia Radio, we want to focus on biblical doctrine, theology. We want to talk about apologetics. We want to bring the biblical worldview into the culture, again, to the exaltation of Christ and a clear communication of the gospel. And with that, you know we've done all kinds of episodes on presuppositional apologetics. We call it reformed apologetic, the biblical apologetic. And now, I think, and I'm really actually, at first I was like curious as to, well, why the shift in name? And now after reading the book, I mean, I love it. Covenantal Apologetics. You guys may have heard Dr. White on The Dividing Line speaking about the moment that Dr. Scott Oliphint had on the Unbelievable radio program, really laying out the biblical apologetic. And it's an excellent series of shows. I recommend that highly to you. But we have on the radio today the author of the book, Covenantal Apologetics, Dr. Scott Oliphint. Dr. Oliphint, how are you today, sir?
Well, after listening to your intro, I feel like I just landed on another planet. Other than that, I'm doing pretty well.
Well, good. Well, hey, Dr. Oliphint, it's an honor really to have you on the show today. And, you know, in the past, we had a very popular episode that just really went worldwide, and it was on American Vision's new film. It was How to Answer the Fool. And I'm not sure if you're familiar with that.
I'm not. I'm sorry.
Okay. Well, it was a film just basically on bringing presuppositional apologetics, what you refer to as covenantal apologetics, to the street level, bringing it to where we can explain how we actually engage the culture with this. And let me tell you, Dr. Oliphint, at first I was like, well, why the shift in name? And it's not like it really essentially would should bother any of us. But I was really compelled with your answer in the book as to the shift in terminology from presuppositional to covenantal apologetics. Could you talk to us about that? I thought that was compelling. Could you talk to us about the shift in name and why to covenantal apologetics from presuppositional apologetics?
Sure. I've been teaching apologetics here now for a little over 20 years, and really about the beginning of my time here at Westminster Seminary. One of the things that struck me as I was thinking about how to communicate apologetics to students in the classroom is that the term presuppositional had been given so many different nuances in our current context. There's one author out there who said something like Van Til was a great precursor to postmodernism because he said, you know, all of us have presuppositions. And so he was trying to relativize the term. And that bothered me. And then I had a conversation many years ago with another apologist in the classical tradition who we were talking about apologetic method. And he said, well, are you presuppositional? And I said, yes. And he said, well, are you Carnelian or Clarkian or Schaeferian or Henrian or all these things? And it sort of started making me think that the term itself is a bit too ambiguous to clearly articulate what Dr. Van Til was trying to do. So, and the other thing is, it's a term that Van Til was sort of given. It was somebody gave him that label, and you know he didn't argue with it, was okay with it. But it's not a term that he himself put onto his own methodology. So in the world of postmodernism and relativism and things like that, I thought there's got to be a better way to do it. And then as I was thinking about starting to teach Van Til's method here at the seminary, it was obvious to me, and something that hasn't been, or at least at that point, hadn't been brought out, I think, as much as it should have been, that theology, specifically Reformed theology, is the foundation of everything that Van Til said. So I thought it's better for us, in order to highlight that principle and also to get rid of some of the ambiguity, to use the biblical and theological term to label the method. Now, I'm not going to go to the mat for that and say anybody who calls it presuppositional is wrong. There's nothing wrong in and of itself with the term, but I just don't think it does what Van Til wanted it to do. In his day and time, when philosophy was more concerned with positivism and brute factuality and things like that, the notion of presupposition was fairly unique in the context in which he was arguing. But it's not anymore. I mean, we live in a post-Kuhnian context where everybody's talking about context and paradigms and prejudices and biases, and a lot of people think that's what a presupposition is. So that's not very helpful. The other side of it is when you read Van Til in his works, the notion of covenant is on almost every page that he writes.
Yes.
And what he means by that is what Scripture means by that, and that is that every person has some kind of relationship to the true and triune God. Nobody is left out of a relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
And so people are either related to God in Christ by grace, or they're related to God in Adam according to mm-hmm. wrath. But each of those is a relationship. It's a covenantal relationship. It's a relationship that God unilaterally set up, that every person is bound to, and that in that relationship, then, we are defined according to how we stand before God. That's a covenant relationship. God established it, and we have a responsibility to understand it and to live according to it. So because of that, I thought it was better, given all of those emphases, that we think about apologetics covenantally, because it helps us see a lot of things. It helps us see that unbelievers, when we approach them with a defense of the Christian faith and with the truth of the Christian gospel, they are already related to God in a particular way and already know Him because of the activity of God Himself.
Well, see, Dr. Oliphint, that right there is what strikes me as so important, is that all this discussion you're having thus far is rooted very firmly in what a Christian should already acknowledge naturally from a reading of Scripture. I mean, we're talking in Christ or in Adam. And so, I mean, go on with that. But I think that's important to note, is that you're approaching this from the start with a foundation of what we should already know and believe about God in the first place.
That's exactly right. And I think it's unfortunate that in so much of apologetics, even in the current day, and certainly historically, it's been orchestrated and conducted within a context strictly of philosophy, and that means that you get your arsenal from philosophy, you get your turns from philosophy, and you do your work in a philosophical context, and that's detrimental to apologetics if apologetics is supposed to be Christian. Now, I deal with philosophy in various ways, and I think it's appropriate to be an expert in philosophy if you're a Christian, but I don't think apologetics is first and foremost a philosophical discipline. It's first and foremost a biblical and theological discipline, and has to be understood in that context, or it's not going to be understood properly.
All right.
Carried out properly.
That is absolutely a wonderful explanation. We will be back, guys. Stay with us. It is an honor and a privilege to have Dr. Scott Oliphint on with us, talking about his new book, Covenantal Apologetics. Stay with us, apologiaradio.com.
Right back.
Welcome back to Apologia Radio. In the studio today with the bear and the girl, Luke Pierce and Joy Timby.
And some bass cannon.
Yeah. Hey guys, apologiaradio.com is where you get us. You're going to want to get this episode, listen to it a bunch of times, and share it with everyone you know. We're talking today with Dr. Scott Oliphint, author of the new book, Covenantal Apologetics. Now, I had seen this book coming up a bunch of times. Jeff Downs from Alpha and Omega Ministries, a big promoter of the book. And I was like, it's interesting. So I was sort of like on standby waiting for the book to come out. Finally came out, ordered the book. And let me tell you, I absolutely love it. I love it. It really is like doing a deep, deep Bible study. I got through the first, say, three chapters, and I was just marking it up. I learned a ton of stuff, not just about how to argue, but about the biblical worldview. I mean, I learned some stuff even that I was like, I completely missed that. I've been in that text a bunch of times, and I just never saw that. So we're honored to have Dr. Oliphint on. Dr. Oliphint, you were talking about, we were talking about, you know, really raising up just this it should be an obvious idea that this is where the scriptures say all of humanity is. We're either in Adam covenantally or in Christ. And you're arguing from that basic standpoint as a beginning and really trying to aim at that, to strike at that point. So Dr. Oliphint, can you talk more about that in the sense of explaining why the change of the title to from presuppositional apologetics to covenantal apologetics?
Yeah, well, one of my concerns that I was saying a minute ago is that apologetics in so many contexts has been completely ripped out of the hands of people in the pews and people in the church, and has been relegated to the supposed academics and elites out there who alone have enough initials behind their name to be able to conduct it. And I think that's a tragedy. I think Scripture is clear. I go through this some in the book in 1 Peter 3:15. Scripture is clear that all of us are commanded by God to be ready to give a defense, to do apologetics. And if God gives us that command, He gives us the tools to do it.
Right.
Well, if it's a philosophical discipline, almost exclusively, then not everyone has the tools to do it. You have to go to school, you have to go to seminary, you have to go to the university, you have to get your PhD in order to be an apologist. And that just doesn't fly with the way that Scripture talks about it. I'm in the middle right now of a kind of written discussion and debate with a classical apologist about some of these issues, and he's writing in his essay to me about how apologetics has to be conducted. And here's what he says. I'm quoting him here. He says, "The first level of apologetics maintains that philosophy is essential in establishing the foundation for dealing with unbelievers." That's a quote unquote.
Right.
Philosophy is essential for dealing with unbelievers. Well, if that's true, then only the philosophers can do it, and the rest of us have to sit by and watch the experts.
Yeah.
Scripture doesn't approach it that way. Scripture gives us the information that we need to deal with unbelievers. Every unbeliever is related to the same God that we're related to. God tells us what's going on to a certain extent in the hearts and lives of those unbelievers. We'll get into that in a minute if you want to.
Yeah, yeah.
And we approach people with the knowledge, as Calvin says, seeing the world and everyone else through the spectacles of Scripture. And then we use the truth of God in order, hopefully, to persuade them of the gospel. And the Holy Spirit, of course, is the only one who can affect that. But it's the truth that the Holy Spirit uses.
Now, Dr. Oliphint, am I right at least bringing this? I know it'll be a point we'll get to at least at some point, but I'm thinking here, when someone describes to me, like, well, it's philosophy, and I think about, like, you know, getting someone to an idea of general theism, like detached from the Word of God as a foundation. Like, I remember, it just you talking about this is reminding me of a fantastic quote that you brought up in the book. And I'm going to quote it for you here. It says, "Generic theism is no part of the Christian faith. Why this is the case will become clear later on. At this point, we need only recognize that any defense that does not include the triune God is a defense of a false theism. Right. And theism of this sort is not a step toward Christianity, but an idolatrous reaction to suppression of the truth. Thus, a belief in theism that is not Christian theism is a sinful suppression of the truth. Hmm. It masks rather than moves toward true knowledge of the triune God." Now, I think that is so important, because I've heard even there's on the film How to Answer the Fool, there is a clip of a discussion that William Lane Craig has with an audience. And he just says, I can't even believe that it came out of his mouth. He said directly, he said, you know, I'm not talking about the biblical God. I'm arguing for general theism here.
Yeah. Yeah, see, and this is a point that I've gotten some pushback on from some guys who don't hold to this method. And, you know, I'm willing to be taught here, but I have to say I haven't read anything in apologetic literature from the other approaches that convinces me that their concern is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Everything that I read has a focus on generic theism. Now, you know, to be fair, these guys, Craig and others, I think are Christians, and they do hold to the reality and truth of the gospel. But my point is not what they believe in their hearts. My point is, what does their method allow for? Mm-hmm. And listen, it's this simple. If you start with anything but the Bible, there is no way to get to the triune God, period, the end. Now, that's just logically sound. There's no way to refute that. If you start with anything but the Bible, there's no way to get to the triune God, because the only way you can get there is by somehow arbitrarily jumping over to Scripture and saying, okay, now I want to talk about this. You know, I want to talk about the truths of Scripture. And somebody who's aware of what you're doing is going to say, wait a minute, we didn't start there. That's not the direction we were going.
Yeah.
So I think that's why when you start with some notion of the neutrality of reason or some neutral notion of evidence, the only place you're going to get to is generic theism. And believe me, Paul at Athens had an audience of generic theists, and he told them, every one of them, they needed to repent or they were going to be eternally condemned.
Right.
So theism gets us nowhere. And to try to argue for theism, I tell my students, if I were involved as an apologetics professor in teaching them how to argue for generic theism, I'd quit my job and go do something else. It's not worth the time invested in it.
Yeah, we're not going to get to the gospel if we're arguing from a general form of theism. And I, Dr. Oliphint, you're exactly right on this point. And I would say, just for an example of a proof of that I think is important, is Richard Dawkins and Lawrence Krauss were at Gamage here in Tempe a little while back, and they were doing just a public discussion. It was a packed out audience. And what's interesting here is that you're not the only one saying this, Dr. Oliphint, because when they were describing the design argument and all these different arguments, they've just brought it out. They said this together in unison. They said, it doesn't mean that Jesus died for your sins. They caught that. They caught the fact that, you know, people were arguing for design and for the moral argument. They said, it doesn't logically follow that that means Jesus died for your sins.
Yeah.
You see, they
got
it. Yeah, that general form of theism, these two savvy unbelievers saw right through those arguments to say, it doesn't mean Jesus is who he says he is.
Right, yeah. And see the example that we have in our contemporary time is Anthony Flew, who spent most of his life as an atheist trying to refute theism, and then toward the end of his life acknowledged that there's something out there maybe that's bigger than he is. And I don't know what was in his heart when he died, but if he died a theist, he went to the same place where he would have gone if he'd stayed an atheist.
That's right.
So what good is that? The goal is wrong if the goal is generic theism. And I think on the other side of it, the reason the goal is generic theism is because it has a faulty theology at bottom.
You see, that's important, and that's something that came out, I think, quite a bit in your discussion on Unbelievable Radio.
Yeah.
And we're going to talk more about that when we get back. So right back here with Dr. Scott Oliphint, Luke Pearson, Joy Temme, me, Jeff Durbin. Right back, ApologiaRadio.com.
We'll be right back.
Energetic, ruthless. Radio gon' play this till you're old and toothless. Even your mom like the LA Sim Crew. More than just music, life channel through the PC. Even if it ain't what you into.
Welcome back to Apologia Radio. In the studio today with Luke Pearson, Joy Temby. On the phone with right now, Dr. Scott Oliphint from Westminster Seminary, talking about covenantal apologetics. You know, Dr. Oliphint, I think one of the things that's going to occur here right off the bat as people are listening, and I know that atheists are listening as well to this show. We have a lot of atheist fans and followers as well that listen in. What they're going to say to you, and I want to just kind of get it out of the way now, is they're going to say, but Dr. Oliphint, you are begging the question. You are just simply saying something without, I mean, you're supposed to be proving what you're saying. You can't do that. You're saying what you should be proving right now. So, Dr. Oliphint, that comes up over and over again. Can you speak to that in this segment?
Yeah, I think, that's a fairly standard retort that people offer, and I think it shows a certain naivete about the way in which the mind works and knowledge works. anybody who asserts anything is simply saying something, and they're saying it on the basis of some kind of authority.
Right.
So the question can be asked, what authority is that? Why should I believe it? And we have an answer for that question if someone asks us that about Scripture. But everyone has to stand someplace. That goes all the way back to Aristotle. So Aristotle asserted certain things and said, in order to assert this, you've got to stand somewhere. And the place on which you stand, you cannot go behind. It has to be a foundation. So we assert a certain foundation, and then we try to show, hopefully persuasively, as the Lord allows, we try to show how that foundation alone is able to answer the questions and the problems and the objections and the situations that come up. So it's not just a bald assertion, it's not just a blind assertion, but of course it's an assertion. That's what happens in a debate. Someone mm-hmm. asserts something, you assert something mm-hmm. else, and then we begin to discuss what the foundations are of those assertions, and hopefully we can move forward in doing that.
Right. Now, I think it's important here for Christians, too, because Christians will often ask this as well, like someone that's more classical or evidentialist in their apologetic method. They'll say, well, I'm concerned with the fact that you're starting with the Word of God as the ultimate authority when that's what you have to prove. I mean, even they'll oftentimes kind of fall into that. But I want to take us, maybe you can correct me here, Dr. Oliphint, would it be proper to take someone back to the garden and the scene in the garden where God is giving his authoritative word? And, I mean, would it be appropriate to say, well, yeah, I mean, Adam and Eve should have obeyed that word because it sounded most reasonable? Or because the greater evidence really displayed that they should really obey that word? Or should they have obeyed that word because God is the ultimate authority who speaks with that ultimate authority, and he is to be obeyed because he is right, because he is true, not because, hey, it looks good to you and your own, you know, assessment of God and his world. I mean, that seems right to you. I mean, is it right to go to that place?
Well, I think it is. I mean, you know, when Moses says Genesis 3:1 that the serpent was more subtle, more crafty than any other beast of the field, he's setting us up there for what's going to be a very subtle and crafty way of temptation. And the first thing he says in the temptation is, has God really said? In other words, the way to go at it is to get people to question what it is God has said, and then, as he does after that, to attempt to try to refute that. And that leads, of course, to utter ruin. So I think what people want to try to do in situations like that is to get us to say, well, if you want me to believe the Bible, you're going to have to prove that the Bible is what mm-hmm. it says it is. And, you know, and what I say to those kinds of situations is, I will prove that. Let's open up the Bible and look at it. No, wait a minute. You have to prove that what you say about the Bible is true, to which I say, the only way to prove a foundation is from that foundation and not trying to get behind it in order to prove it.
Excellent.
And it's the same for anybody's foundation, no matter what foundation they stand on. Yeah. So there's no way to get behind.
Looks like we just lost him there. We'll pull him back in. I think that let's go ahead and continue on as we pull him back into the show here. It's important to notice here in discussing covenantal apologetics, presuppositional apologetics, what Dr. Oliphint is really aiming at here is just the point that you're going to have an ultimate authority, an ultimate standard. It's going to be there regardless of who you are. If your ultimate standard is reason, then you're going to have that as your ultimate standard. If you talk to an unbeliever, you say, well, what's your ultimate authority? Like, I use my reason, so reason is your ultimate authority. But here's the thing. Reason doesn't justify itself in the sense of being necessary, unchanging, all those different things. There has to be something actually that is actually greater than, bigger than even human reason, because the unbeliever will say, well, I use my reasoning to find out truth and discover truth. But the truth is, how do you know your reasoning is even a valid thing? You see, that doesn't provide for you the preconditions necessary for the intelligibility of the world, of the world of thought, of information, of anything. And so I like that. No matter what, everybody's going to have an ultimate authority. And we know who that is. It's the triune God of the Scriptures. We'll be right back with more of Dr. Oliphint right here, ApologiaRadio.com.
Apologia Radio will be right back.
Episodes, go to Facebook, like the page. on the radio today with Dr. Scott Oliphint. Excited about the new book, Covenantal Apologetics. You should be excited to pick up a copy of this book. It is amazing and excellent. I want to encourage you guys, not just for the purposes of being able to learn how to debate or argue your position, but in reality, you're going to get through the first couple of chapters of this book, and you're going to feel like you are just getting fed scripture. And I feel like, honestly, a joy, when I picked it up and I was reading through it, it was reminiscent for me from the first time that I picked up Always Ready by Dr. Greg Bahnsen, where the first couple chapters, it took me by surprise, coming from an evidentialist background, that I was getting fed. I was being challenged as a Christian from the Word of God. And I really felt kind of that way. It was reminiscent to me in that way. You picked up the book and you got a chance to read through it a little bit too. Talk about that, because before we go into the rest and the explanation, I'd like you to kind of fill our listeners in on how it's impacted you.
Well, what I really like about it is that, I guess that Dr. Oliphint, he addresses this on Unbelievable, which we talked about. Mm-hmm. I think there's always this assertion that people who are presuppositional, or I guess now covenantal, mm-hmm. That they are anti-evidence.
Right,
right.
But there's a lot of, like you said, you start reading the book and you, in the first few chapters, you've hardly even touched really how to evangelize. It's just a lot of it is just evidence, scripture. Mm-hmm. So he's not just giving you like this book on how to preach to people or why I'm right, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. or whatever. It's a lot of scripture, a lot of stuff. Yeah. That you don't necessarily always think about, things you mm-hmm. missed or, mm-hmm. and that's what I like about it, because I feel like people just think like, okay, so, you know, so I have no reasoning.
Yeah.
I have no reason to believe this. I don't know, people and Christians, I particularly notice they do. They just say, okay, well, awesome. So you get them to admit that they're wrong. And then what do you do?
Right, right. Where do you go from
there? It's like, well,
wait a second, what's the point of this discussion? Right, right. And that was what bothers me too, is what I always try to stress to people. It's like, you know, listen, if my aim is simply to learn information and facts to argue with people, no thanks. I mean, I agree. Let's check out. I'm done with that. Like, it's about the gospel. It's about bringing people to Christ, to know him. Isn't that the whole point? I mean, isn't it like our motivation initially as people who learn apologetics is just that, is to win someone to Christ, in a sense, to point them to Jesus and faith in him to be reconciled to God. It never was just about argumentation, was it? I mean, isn't it coming from a heart that loves people and desires them to know God? And that's just what this is about, is those biblical foundations and pointing people to the true God. Dr. Oliphint, before we lost you there, we were talking about ultimate foundations, that everybody has an ultimate foundation and you can't get behind that. And with that, it reminded me of a question that came up as I notified people you were going to be on. We have an atheist friend of ours that asked a question. His name is William. He asked the question like this, and maybe this will help you kind of expand on what you were saying. He says, does covenantal apologetics rely on circular reasoning? He says, that isn't assuming God exists as your way of proving God exists a circular argument? I know we were kind of getting into that, but I'll let you sort of respond to that.
Yeah, and the answer to that would be yes, as long as the person doesn't think that the way that he argues is non-circular. I would say yes, arguing in the same way that anybody else argues. You know, I had a discussion and debate with a number of professors overseas a couple of years ago, and none of them, as far as I know, was a Christian. And in the midst of my discussion, we were talking about Kantian philosophy and the problems with Kant and the way in which that had affected Western intellectual thought. And toward the end of the discussion, one of the professors spoke up and he said, wait a minute, you're just telling us that the Bible is authoritative because it says it's authoritative, and that's a circular argument. What reason do you have for asserting such a thing? And I said, well, I'll be happy to answer that question, but let me just say that all of the presentations that have been given so far are saying exactly the same thing, that the reason you believe X is because you assert X, or somebody else has said X, and so now you've got an authority. And what reason do I have to believe your authority? So the question always comes to, where do we stand in order to assert what it is we are asserting? And again, this is not something new. This has about a 5,000-year pedigree, at least in terms of what's in writing. So I think, you know, your atheist friend asked a good question, but I think it would help him to understand that when he says he believes X or believes Y, there's some authority behind that on which he stands and which he will have to give an account in order to make sense of the position that he wants to affirm.
Right, right. Well, someone says to you, okay, Dr. Oliphint, why the Bible? Why assert that? Like, why does that hold so much weight? That's what they'll throw back at you.
Right. And see, and that's a great question, and that could lead into a few hours discussion, couldn't it? But I think the bottom line answer to that is because you want to say, unless you understand the Bible to be the Word of God and take it for what it says, you have no way of explaining anything in the world, including the question, why the Bible?
Yes.
If there's going to be meaningful predication at all, if there's going to be any understanding of who I am as a person, if there's going to be any real understanding of the world, you have to take God at his word. You can't take Satan at his word, has God said. You have to take God at his word and understand that he has said that. He's defined himself. He's defined who we are. He's defined his world. And unless we take it in that way, then we're lost in a sea of meaninglessness, no matter how much we want to put on a facade of meaning.
Excellent. Excellent answer. Okay, Dr. Oliphint, if I could, I'm going to try to move us through, I thought, were the important points in the beginning of the book. You bring out, after describing covenantal apologetics, and I think it's a great term, by the way. I think it's wonderful. You talk about the 10 tenets that are sort of at the foundation of the discussion here. And I want to just sort of throw them out at you, and you just give us the explanation. I'll kind of hit you up with them. So the first one you said is, number one, the faith that we are defending must begin with and necessarily include the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who, as God, condescends to create and redeem. Now, we sort of talked about that a second ago, but maybe just fill us in a little more on that.
What I'm trying to say there and trying to emphasize again is that when we start with Scripture and what God has said, we are at the same time beginning with the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who is the only true God. You know, we are monotheists, but we're monotheists in a Trinitarian way. We're not monotheists in any other way. Mm. And so when we start with Scripture, we recognize that God is who he says he is. And because he is who he says he is, then the world is what he says it is, and redemption is what he said it is, and sin is what it says. And so the only way we can include any of those crucial and central elements in our defense of Christianity is if we start with what God says about the world. The world is what God says it is. It's not anything else. And so if someone comes to us and says, this is what the world is like, and it's not consistent with what God has said, then we know it's false. We know that because God has spoken. And so we always go into our apologetic discussion with an understanding of what God has said about the Bible and with an understanding that God is not just the one God, but he is the one God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And because of that, you see, then we can begin to move toward redemption and sin and what that means in the same way that Paul did, for example, at the Areopagus. Paul began with God's characteristics there when he's talking to the Epicureans and the Stoics and the other Athenians. He began with who God is as he proclaimed to them who they thought was an unknown God. And Paul knew that the reason they had that idol was because they were suppressing the truth. It wasn't because they were ignorant of God. So he tells them who the true God is. But then he concludes with the fact that God will come in the person of the Son to judge all men. And so it's incumbent on all of us, myself and everyone else, to submit to him and to repent before him. And that's the only solution to any of the questions and problems that come up in life. If you don't know the Bible, you've got nothing to say.
Dr. Oliphint, this is such a blessing, man. And you know what's amazing here, guys? I want to just talk about this. Like, think about for a second, just listeners listening in, believers who are like, you know, contemplating apologetic method and everything else. You know, not only do you have something here that's philosophically rigorous, but you have something that's biblically faithful. I mean, I'm going to ask this question honestly to brothers and sisters out there listening to this show. What would you prefer to stand before the Lord Jesus with, in a sense of how I've engaged? Would you rather stand before him saying, Lord, I stood on what you said about you, about them, about this world. I stood on what you said. I went with that. And when I talked to the world and I displayed you to the world, or when I argued for you, I stood on what you said about them, about me. Or would you rather stand before him saying, Lord, I didn't want to assume your word. I wanted to try to make sure that I can provide a foundation that you are who you say you are and go some other route. I mean, I just think that this seems so obvious to me. I know a lot of us can get heavy, guys, and philosophically high level in a matter of like discussion and language. But it's as simple as that, I think, ultimately, is that how do I want to represent the King of Glory? That's what I think is so amazing here. It's okay. The second one, Dr. Oliphint, was second tenet here. You said God's covenantal revelation is authoritative by virtue of what it is. And any covenantal Christian apologetic will necessarily stand on and utilize that authority in order to defend Christianity.
That's right. See, here's the thing. God has made himself known, and this is another tenet, but I have to get into it here in order to address that one. God has made himself known to every person. Paul's clear about that in Romans 1. There are other passages we could point to. And he's made himself known in such a way that every person knows God and clearly understands who God is, not because they've thought about it clearly, but because God has made himself known clearly. His revelation gets through. Now, because of that, whenever we communicate the truth of God as we have it from Scripture, it automatically connects with the truth of God that God has given and put into every person. So it's truth connecting with truth when we use the truth of God. And because of that, I think we need to recognize again the fact that it's God the Holy Spirit who uses that truth to convert the hearts of people. And he doesn't promise to use anything else. He can use whatever he wants to. I mean, I've heard people say, you know, I was converted to Christianity because of Buddhism. Well, that's fine, but we don't go around and preach Buddhism so people be converted.
Right.
What we have is the Word of God, and we speak the Word of God truthfully. And when we do that, you see, it connects with the truth that God is giving and has already given to every person that he's made, because every person is made in his image.
Yes. Okay, so the Christian apologetic will necessarily stand on and utilize that authority in order to defend Christianity.
That's right. The truth of God comes to God's own creatures in an authoritative way. In other words, they may say, oh, I don't believe that. Oh, you got to prove that. I don't like that. I disagree with it. It still comes with God's authority. It is self-attesting in that way.
Okay.
God's word never returns void. It always comes with his full authority, even when it's rejected.
You see, okay, Dr. Oliphint, this is amazing. I had a Roman Catholic call me yesterday from across the country, about an hour and a half long discussion. And it's amazing here that this is, it was interesting, is that what you describe here in this second point here, this tenet, not only has to do with the discussion we have with, say, the atheist, the agnostic, the person who professes, you know, unbelief, but we also have this as a necessary foundation for even like canon issues and issues with Rome.
Right.
You noted here, it says, note that the confession, talking about Westminster Confession, is focusing here on Scripture's authority. That authority is not something that comes to it from the outside. It is not something given to or imposed on Scripture by another external authority, not by any man or church. Rather, Scripture's authority is tied inextricably to its author, God himself. And what's amazing here, Dr. Oliphint, is that when I was in this canon discussion with this Roman Catholic yesterday, like that again became a central issue, is that becomes an epistemological issue. How do you know this is the Word of God? And the Roman Catholic says what? Well, because the Church authoritatively declares it to be so.
That's right. The Church authoritatively declares it to be so, and so your final authority, the place on which you stand, is the Church.
Amen.
And what the Church has said. Yeah. And that then becomes your foundation, and then Scripture and the Bible is your secondary foundation. And I can tell you, as one who was raised in the Roman Catholic Church, secondary foundation has no place in the home of a Roman Catholic. You just do what the Church says. You just follow the fides implicitas. That's all you're meant to do as a Roman Catholic, because the Church will guide you, because the Church is the final authority. And the Reformers saw that. You cannot have two ultimate authorities side by side. There's one and only one. It's either the Bible, or it's some other person, or it's some other institution, or something like that. And that's why when we stand on Scripture, we're just saying this is what everyone has to do, stand somewhere. The only place I can stand is on what God has said.
Amen. You see how the covenantal apologetic moves not just to the area of unbelief and atheism, but also even in the sense of other religions like Mormonism or Roman Catholicism. We'll be right back. ApologiaRadio.com.
Hi. How many books do you know of that address topics of education and welfare, local government, state government, taxation, money and banking, free markets, courts, war and the military, and the executive power? How many books do you know actually talk about these topics from a biblical perspective and set forth all of the issues, ideas, the history, and the hurdles, and the blueprints for the way forward? Hi, I'm Joel McDermott with AmericanVision.org. In Restoring America, One County at a Time, I cover all these topics and more, showing you how America was once free, how those freedoms were lost, and giving you an uncompromising biblical approach to get those freedoms back. I focus on practical steps, local solutions, personal sacrifices, and it has a multi-generational vision. So don't just sit around talking about Restoring America. Actually do something. And you can start by getting my book, Restoring America, One County at a Time, at AmericanVision.org.
What's up, y'all? This is the Gospel Heard Around the World. Joy Tempe, Luke Pearson. Are you guys loving this?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
You see, that was interesting because yesterday I have this phone call. Roman Catholic from across the country calls me up, immediately peppers me with questions. I mean, I don't even know the number. And just, hello, and Jeff, I have questions for you. And just starts firing away. And what it kept coming back to over and over and over as I'm giving him the word and giving him the gospel. And he every single time. Every single time, I eventually got to the point where I kept stopping him saying, okay, please notice what's just happened here. I want you to please to think, humbly, I want you to think about this, is that I've given you the words of God, and your only response is to go back to the church, which mm-hmm. is authoritative, that declares this to you. And what's amazing here is that that was it. That was his ultimate authority. When you have two authorities running alongside one another, the Bible and another authority, that other authority begins to eat up the Bible and destroy it and become the ultimate authority. And so what's amazing is as I was reviewing the book last night, sort of highlighting some stuff I wanted to talk about, I hit that and I thought, that is it. People ask the question, how does covenantal apologetics, presuppositional apologetics, how does that engage the area of the cults or other mm-hmm. religions?
Because people do, they accuse it of, actually I've heard people, earlier we were talking about just sort of general theism.
Right.
I've heard people say that all presuppositional supports is, eventually you'll get the non-believer to agree that there's some sort of general God out there. Mm. And I've heard that.
Interesting.
People say that that's really just where it gets you to. Oh, and then weird. If you want to use evidence, then maybe you'll be able to get them to believe in, you know, the Judeo-Christian God.
Interesting.
But that's just, as this conversation you had with this Catholic proves right. that it doesn't just get you to general theism. Mm. If you did it incorrectly, mm-hmm. it could get you to general theism. Mm-hmm. But if you used it correctly, and actually, I guess that's why I like the term change to covenantal, because the covenant actually does, it's a biblical word and it does describe something that's happening.
I like that you said that. See, that's what's interesting too, is it's just what you, that's good. That's good. That I think that might be actually why I like that term so much, because it does begin to have you enter the discussion, immediately recognize the covenant that you're in with God.
It's not just that everyone presupposes something, because I think that's a simple enough argument to make.
It becomes like a philosophical hard, like, what do you mean they're presupposing? Like, my wife is like, you got to go slow with me. I get, you know, I'm like, babe, it's so simple. And I think that's what makes it easier, is that Dr. Oliphint is putting it in the terms of covenant.
Yeah.
And I really, exactly. I think it's what I enjoyed so much about it. So Dr. Oliphint, we're back. And the third point in your tenets here is, it is the truth of God's revelation together with the work of the Holy Spirit that brings about a covenantal change from one who is in Adam to one who is in Christ. And you touched on that a little bit, but can you describe that a little further?
Yeah, I think that's something that every Christian would believe, but unfortunately it hasn't been applied that much to apologetics. People do this, obviously. I mean, here's the way I do it in class sometimes. When people ask me questions about apologetic method, and I immediately say to them, well, is that how you would practice evangelism? Oh, no, what? No, in evangelism, we're telling people about the gospel. Well, when you tell people about the gospel, what do you stand on to do that? Well, you have to stand on Scripture. That's where the gospel is.
Right.
Exactly. Well, why do you stand on Scripture when the unbelievers you're talking to don't believe Scripture? You know, and then you get these silent look, these silent faces, and, you know, blank faces. They're starting to think and see the reason why you have to stand on the Bible to say anything you're going to say. So it's the truth of God that changes hearts. Now, we know, because we're Reformed, that the Holy Spirit alone is the ultimate persuader. But we also know that the Holy Spirit uses the truth of God to change the hearts of people. And so a successful apologetic, if I could put it this way, is not an apologetic where you win the argument. We're not out there with a kind of secular mentality that we're going to beat somebody up intellectually. You know, you could make the argument that Jesus didn't win the argument. They hung him on a cross. That Paul didn't win the argument. He was stoned and persecuted. But what we're doing is we're communicating the truth of God so that the Spirit will use that, and it will become either an aroma of life in the sovereign Spirit's work or a stench of death. But either way, it accomplishes God's purposes. Anything other than that is meaningless, is not worth communicating. So we're not going to dumb down Christianity to make it something that's acceptable to a mind that is bent against the truth of God. Why would we do that? Why would we stand where someone else is standing when they're drowning in quicksand? It's just not worth it.
We stand
on Scripture, and we speak the truth of God as the Lord allows.
And that, how much confidence does that give us as believers, as sort of a comfort and rest in a sense, but also sort of a boldness? That's what Dr. Bonson always says, those two points, humble boldness. It's just that what you just said there is that, look at the two points here on number three, guys. Here's what he says. He says, it is the truth of God's revelation together with the work of the Holy Spirit that brings about the covenantal change. So what's that telling you? Watch this. Those two things. Number one, the truth of God's revelation. So what's that? His word, not yours. Got it? And then the second thing is the Holy Spirit's work of regeneration and opening their eyes and their heart. So what's that mean? You're the messenger. Mm-hmm. You are just there being faithful, and that's a worship moment for you between you and God, honoring God and loving this person. But the thing to get there is that this isn't about your intellectual fancy footwork and the amount of time and hours you put into just, you know, memorizing facts and chewing on stuff and working through the books and texts. But this is it really about the Word of God. The gospel, which is the power of God for salvation, the Holy Spirit of God who brings about regeneration, what's that do? It gives you confidence and hope in that you can do this.
That's right. It gives you confidence and it gives you content. And apart from Scripture, you just don't have any content. I was preaching at a church downtown Philadelphia about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and a man came up to me after the church service, and he said, "I want to shake your hand." He said, "I was an atheist about 6 months ago." And he said, "I was trolling around the internet and kept seeing all these Vantillians out there." And so he said, "I started reading what some of their arguments were." And he said, "It kind of intrigued me." So he said, I ordered Defense of the Faith. And he said, started reading that. And in the fourth edition, some of my comments are in there. And he said, started reading those comments. And he said, I just want to let you know that this weekend I became a member of this church. So this is the ideal situation, because what he was understanding from, he said these Vantillians were causing problems for the atheists online. The reason they're causing problems is because the truth confronts authoritatively. And, and even if people put up a facade of, "I don't care about that," you know, and I know that the truth of God is getting right through to their hearts every time it's spoken. And in God's providence, this man was converted because he was reading not just about how to be a theist. He was reading about the reality of the gospel.
Oh, man, this is great. This is good stuff. Okay, Dr. Oliphint, number four. Man, male and female, as image of God, is in covenant with the triune God for eternity. Now, that's going to pique people's curiosity. What in the world do you mean by that?
Well, if we think about what it means to be image, again, the Bible defines and describes who we are, and apart from that, there aren't any descriptions or definitions that have any meaning. So the Bible tells us that we are image of God. Now, if you think about what an image is, think of a mirror image. An image always requires the original and is always and everywhere only dependent on the original to be what it is. So because we are image of God, we are dependent on the original, who is God. We live our lives really in the presence of God, like a mirror image, and our responsibility in the presence of God is to be like God. To the extent that we are not doing that, to that extent, we are under wrath. When we are converted by grace, then we are not under wrath, but under grace, not because we are so obedient, but because of what Christ has accomplished. But in each of those contexts, you see, there's a relationship to God, so that even in eternity future, there's only one of two places where every person will be. Those who are in Christ will spend eternity in the new heavens and the new earth, not in heaven, in the new heavens and the new earth, with the Lamb and with God. And those who are in Adam will spend eternity in eternal condemnation in hell. But you see, hell will still be the presence of God. They will it's because they are covenant creatures that they'll be in hell. It's because they are responsible to God that they will be eternally condemned by God and eternally under his wrath. All of that has to do with God's covenantal commitment to his creatures to make us in his image.
Dr. Oliphint, this is an excellent quote. I made sure I underlined it and circled it because I was like, oh, this is an excellent way to put this. I think related to what you're saying now, you say on page 43, this was in part Calvin's point in beginning the Institutes as he did. Nearly all the wisdom we possess, that is to say, true and sound wisdom, consists of two parts, the knowledge of God and of ourselves. Now, you say here, there can be no separation between the knowledge of God and the knowledge of ourselves. To the extent that we know ourselves truly, to that extent we know God truly. The two are inextricably moored. This is part of what it means to be the image of God. To try to know ourselves without knowing God would be like trying to know our image in a mirror when we are not standing in front of it. There would be no image because the original would not be there. True self-knowledge depends on God knowledge and vice versa. So it is also that in the act of knowing, to the extent that we know ourselves truly, we know it as created, that is, as having its origin and its sustaining existence in God. To claim to know something while thinking it to be independent of God, or to deny that there is a God, is to fail to know it for what it really is. Whatever it is created and sustained by God at every moment.
Exactly. And I think that's such an important point to emphasize because, again, it tells us that the only way we can know our world and know ourselves is if we know it in terms of what God has said about it and about us. There's no other way to do it. If we start from ourselves, how can we know ourselves? We have no transcendent perspective on who we are unless God gives it to us. So, again, we have to always defer to the truth of God. See, I think the important point here, if I could just make this point, because I know, as you said, that sometimes there are atheists listening in on this, the point is not that I'm right or that you're right or that we speak here because we're so smart and we're so authoritative. The point is we're trying to turn people to the Word of God and say, open it up, take it and read it, and see if it doesn't tell you who you are and what the world is like and what your responsibilities are. And it will, and it'll do that authoritatively. I was in a discussion, kind of a mini debate a number of years ago with a philosopher at a local university here, and at the end of our debate, one of the students got up and was fairly hostile toward me, apparently, and he kind of pointed his finger to both of us, and he said, I want to know something. I want to know why I should believe either one of you. In terms of what you've said. And so the philosopher said to me, he said, I want you to go first on that one. So I went up to the microphone and I said, that's a good question. Why should you believe me? And I said, my honest answer is you really shouldn't. But I said, since you're going to challenge me, I'll challenge you. I want you to go back to your dorm tonight. And I want you to find a Bible and start reading the Gospel of John. And I said, if you do that, you are duty bound under God to believe every word that you read. So don't believe me, but believe what you're reading in that book. And then, you know, I said a couple other things and sat down.
Well,
then
Dr. Oliphint, we're going to commercial break. I'm going to continue to be continued. I want to hear the rest of the story right after the break.
Apology Radio will be right back.
Apologiaradio.com. Get us, guys, at the website. Go to Facebook, like our page. Tons of content, tons of past episodes. We've got a lot of videos Debates we've done, public debates, stuff we've done in bringing the gospel on the street to Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, all kinds of stuff on our page. So go to the page, interact with us there. On the radio today with Dr. Scott Oliphint talking about his new book, Covenantal Apologetics. I think you need to grab this episode. You need to pull it down MP3. You need to share with people you know. Listen to it a bunch of times. I would hope that you are starting to get the sense now in listening to this as to why covenantal apologetics and as to why we should approach the world with the gospel in this way. I mean, you have essentially been doing the last hour or so a Bible study, and it's an amazing thing. So, Dr. Oliphint, the next thing, now this is the controversial one, and this is the one that on your discussion on the radio, on Unbelievable Radio, this is the one that your opponent at the moment for the discussion wasn't quite there. And that is the fifth tenet here. You said all people know the true God, and that knowledge entails covenantal obligations. Now, the episode on Unbelievable, guys, started off, and Justin brought up the point that presuppositionalists, covenantal apologists, will say to the unbeliever, you really do know God.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, and that's where he was like, Justin was like, he's so British. He's like, you know, and that could offend them, right? Yeah. And like, to be so offended by that. And just like, okay. But Dr. Oliphint, could you explain that? Because that's a core issue there. All people know the true God.
Right. See, that should be obvious, but I guess it's not in so many of apologetic discussions. There are two things I would say about that. Number one, the man that was talking with me on Unbelievable, I think his response was, he said something like, I agree that, you know, some people know that there's a God or something like that. And that wasn't the point I was trying to make. The point I was trying to make is Paul's point in Romans 1, which is not that there are some people out there who know that there's something bigger or some people out there who may be theists. Paul's point in Romans 1 is to explicate what the image of God is since the fall of man. And what he's saying about that is that the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against ungodliness and unrighteousness because in our sinfulness, in Adam, we suppress the truth in unrighteousness. And then Paul goes on to talk about what that truth is, which is, as a matter of fact, in verse 20, that we know the invisible attributes, the eternal power, divine nature of God, such that we are without excuse. So Paul's here giving what every commentator understands to be a universal indictment of sin as he sets up what he's going to explain about the gospel beginning in earnest in chapter 3 in Romans. So the point that Paul is making is that every person knows the true God. Now, that's a biblical principle. It's exegetically and theologically sound. And then we have to decide how that fits into our apologetic methodology.
Right.
If every person knows the true God, then every person to whom we speak is doing two things, knowing God and suppressing that truth in unrighteousness. Mm. And so we try to get at what that knowledge is going to look like, what that suppression is going to look like, and try to orchestrate our apologetic in biblical terms instead of just wondering where these people are and having no biblical principles that we can proceed by.
Can you help us with that, our listeners? When you say, so, are you saying sort of to tease that out, to try to figure out how you can show them that they do know Him and they're suppressing that truth? Are you saying that each encounter? Obviously, this isn't scripted. See, that's what I love too about this. It's not scripted. And so, is it that each encounter we have with a person that we care for and we want to see reconciled to God, is it that we're trying to find in the discussion where that image of God is popping up?
Exactly. And you know, I was trying to say to the Unbelievable folks, look, you don't go into an apologetic discussion and just blurt out every biblical principle that you know. That's not the way you try to persuade people. But these are things that you may have to say at some point, may want to say or need to say at some point, and then how you say them is going to be different according to whom you speak. But if you look, for example, at Paul at Acts 17, why does Paul at the Areopagus, why does he quote from two Greek poets in his discussion with the philosophers and the Athenians? Well, because Paul knows, I'm pretty sure he knows since he wrote it, that every person knows God, and he knows that there's suppression of the truth. Now, how does that suppression look in Athens? Well, what it looks like is a bunch of idols that moved Paul to talk to people in the synagogue and the marketplace in the first place. So it looks like idolatry. And so what Paul does is he quotes from these Greek poets, in him you live and move and exist, one quote, and then we are his offspring, the second quote. Now, why does Paul use those quotations? Because he knows that those quotations are an illustration of the suppression of the truth. They try to affirm something ultimate, like a God, but they are false statements in the context in which they are written, because when Epimenides says, in him we live and move and exist, the in him means in Zeus. So in that sense, it's a false statement. Paul has already described to the Athenians and the philosophers who God is, and then the reference point for those quotations now becomes the true God instead of a false God. What's Paul doing? He's taking what they've suppressed in unrighteousness, even while they want to affirm some kind of deity, and he's transformed and transplanted those statements into a Christian context to make them true. Now, that's what we do in any kind of philosophy, because any philosophy or worldview or system or view of unbelief, any of those is going to have elements of kind of transcendence in them, where they want to affirm something grander and bigger than we are, but also in the context of that, elements of suppression. We want to try to see those and find those and work with those in such a way that we can communicate the truth by virtue of them. That's what persuasion helps us do, I think.
Excellent. And so the next point, number six, you say, and it's sort of related to what you just said, it's those who are and remain in Adam suppress the truth that they know. Those who are in Christ see the truth for what it is.
Hmm. Right. So they're suppressing the truth, which means, presupposes, they have to have the truth. And having the truth, then they're going to try to hold that down. I've used the illustration before, and I think my discussion recently with Dr. White, he said he uses this illustration as well. So apparently it's gotten around. I don't know where it came from, but I used the one in class someone trying to hold down a beach ball underwater. Yeah. And you try to suppress it and hold it down and hold it under, but eventually it's going to pop up. It's going to pop up. And that's what people are doing in their attempt to suppress the truth and unrighteousness. You can't hold it down completely because you're God's creature living in God's world. So there are always going to be places, areas, that are going to seek to transcend the mundane. And those are just suppression points where we can try to grab onto those and say, why would you do this? Why would you think this way? Why would you believe such a thing? Why would Kant even pause in a noumenal when it has no content? Why does Hegel even care about a concrete universal that's absolute when he can't even tell you what it is until the end? Why do these things even come into philosophies? Because people are suppressing the truth and unrighteousness and will not stand on the Word of God and submit to God in doing that. And so part of what we do in apologetics is try to bring out those points and help people understand that only by standing on Scripture you're going to be able to make sense of any of this.
Amen. We'll be right back after this break. More Covenantal Apologetics with Dr. Scott Oliphint. Stay with us. Come right back.
Apologia Radio. We'll be right back.
Where is my mind?
Welcome back to Apologia Radio. This is a gospel heard around the world. Jesus is the Lord of glory, the Lord of these airwaves. I'm in the studio with Joy Temby, Luke Pearson, on the radio with Dr. Scott Oliphint. New book, Covenantal Apologetics. I know that when we have guests on, I'm always encouraging you guys to go pick up the stuff and everything else. And so you hear me say that a lot. And that's because we're making sure we get people on that we really think are going to bless you and bring glory to Christ. But let me just really say something. I cannot recommend highly enough this book, Covenantal Apologetics. Get it. It is so important in the sense that it really takes what is so essential. It really condenses it, puts it together in an easy to understand way. It'll bless your life. It will, it just makes, in your own mind, God so much more grand because you're in the scriptures, you're in the text, and you just feel so edified and blessed. And it will get you into a rigorous apologetic and defense of the faith. Dr. Oliphint, one of the questions that keeps coming up, and I'd really like to hear how you respond to this, and it came up as a question on the page as we asked, does anybody want to ask Dr. Oliphint anything, was the issue of how this approach would differ from, say, Clark's approach or Clarkian apologetic?
Yeah, I think briefly, you know, what I would say is that while there might be some similarities between what I'm saying, what Van Til said, and what Clark said, I think the fundamental difference is seen in Clark's Wheaton lecture, where he sort of improvised, paraphrased John 1:1. In the beginning was logic, and logic was with God, and logic was God. I think if you begin to think that way, so that what has to be foundational, principial, in everything that you do and think is law of non-contradiction and things like that, as important as those things are, when you begin to think that way, then you wind up saying, as Clark himself did in his last book on the Incarnation, that we have to confess that, that Jesus Christ was two persons, which historically is a heresy, and I think exegetically you could show it to be a heresy as well. So you don't want to move in that direction. Logic is an analog to the character of God, and therefore has to have its foundation in the triune God as well.
That's right. That's exactly right. I had a discussion with someone who holds to that methodology, and that's what I kept coming to. I was like, but even that has to have a foundation. And so I see that as an excellent point. Okay, the seventh point or tenet, you say, there is an absolute covenantal antithesis between Christian theism and any other opposing position. Now, I love this. Listen, and here's this wonderful statement, and I think it's empowering. It says, thus, Christianity is true, and anything opposing it is false.
Right, and I think this, like you say, this should be an encouragement to every Christian, because none of us has the time or energy or ability to look into every false view out there that we might encounter. I mean, some people think, you know, are under the illusion that all we do in academics is study all the false views so that we're experts on every one of them. Well, we're not. None of us has the time or intellect or ability to do that. But we know this going in because of what God has said, not because we're so smart. That Christianity is true. What God says about the world is the way the world is. What God says about us, the way we are. What he says about himself is the way he is. Anything then that opposes that, even if we don't know the details of it, is automatically false. And false doesn't mean simply that someone holds false propositions in their mind. That's too abstract. False means that what they believe, what they say is true, does not square with or match with the way the world really is. So they can't think it consistently, they can't live it consistently, and so apologetically we try to show them that.
Yes, and I think what's going to come back, of course, Dr. Oliphint, people are going to say something effective, well, that's just arrogance. You're just an arrogant, prideful guy. But I think this comes down to an issue of certainty. Right. And truth. I mean, look, someone is wrong here. Okay.
Well, that's right. And see, again, we have to go back to the gospel. I don't say this because I'm so great and powerful. I'm not Oz or something, you know, the great and powerful. I say this because this is what God has said. I say this because God has communicated to us. I say this because God has spoken. So it has nothing to do with me. It all points to what God has said and to what Christ has done. So there's not meant to be any arrogance or pride in that. It's meant to be a submission to what God has said.
Excellent. Excellent explanation. Now, okay, number eight, the eighth tenet here, and this segment's wrapping up here in a minute. I'm going to go ahead and read it now. When we get back from the break, you can respond and sort of explain it to us. Number eight, the tenet in covenantal apologetics is suppression of the truth, like the depravity of sin, and this is good, is total but not absolute. Thus, every unbelieving position will necessarily have within it ideas, concepts, notions, and the like that it has taken and wrenched from their true Christian context. And I think that that is important, too, because what people will often say is, you know, if there's total depravity, if people are depraved, if people are sinful, if they're lost and they're suppressing the truth of God, then they can't reason. Then they can't observe and take information in because they're totally depraved and they're suppressing the truth. So there's no point in argumentation, which I think is a fallacious a statement. It's just a misunderstanding of the position. So we'll be right back. You don't want to miss this last segment right here on Apologia Radio, talking about covenantal apologetics with Dr. Scott Oliphint.
Right back.
Raise me up from the ground, yeah. I've been here too long. I said, Lord, raise me up. the ground. I've been here too long. I said, Lord, raise me up from the ground.
I can't tell you guys how much I am absolutely thoroughly enjoying this. I believe this episode is probably one of the most important episodes we've done by way of instruction and teaching and foundations, because we've done episodes where we've had atheists on, we've done these discussions, we've talked about it, you've seen it sort of in motion, but giving you the foundations is I think the most important thing. That's what we're doing right now. So again, I want to encourage you guys. Dr. Oliphint, where would you like me to send people to get a copy of the book?
Probably best place is WTSbooks.com. Westminster Bookstore usually has best price and best shipping and all that sort of thing. So WTSbooks.com.
WTSbooks.com. Again, it's Covenantal Apologetics. Okay, so we were just left off that last segment there talking about the suppression of truth, like the depravity of sin is total but not absolute. Dr. Oliphint, I think you get, you know, kind of what I was aiming at there. People will often say, well, then if this is true, if your foundations are true, then they couldn't know anything. They couldn't reason. They couldn't observe. I mean, but that's not really what we're getting at there, is it?
No, it's not, because by God's common grace, what I call his universal mercy, when sin came into the world, God did not destroy man. We still remained image of God, even though that image was marred. So because we are image of God, we still live in God's world. And see, the thing is, if a person was going to consistently suppress the truth in unrighteousness, the only way to do that is to completely annihilate and destroy your entire environment, which, of course, is impossible. But it's back to Camus' assertion, right? The only serious question left is suicide at that point. So because people are not consistent, they're going to take things from God's world. They're going to continue to affirm things that are close to what Christianity affirms, even though they have no right to those things, because there's no other way to exist in God's world as God's creature. So a person who says, for example, I love my wife, you know, Schaefer was very good at this kind of critique. He would talk about driving people to despair and taking the roof off. So he would ask a person who says, who's an utter materialist and says, I love my wife, he would say, how can you know such a thing? Why would you even do that? Given that we are nothing more than matter plus time plus chance, what does love have to do with that? See, that's one of those transcendent qualities that people want to hold on to. Even their own worldview won't allow for such a thing. So what do you do in apologetics? You grab onto those kinds of things and help people see that the only way to understand what love is and who your wife is and what a family is if God defines those things for us. And so now we're dependent, again, as image, on the Word of God, on God to speak to us, to define those things for us. And we can do that all across the board in difficult and complex philosophies, from that even down to just normal statements that people make on a day-to-day basis.
Excellent. Luke, you had something you wanted to talk to him about. Go ahead and fill in there.
Yeah, well, first I just want to thank you for blessing us. I've just been sitting here soaking this all up, so this has been awesome. But I was listening to Dr. White's breakdown of the show that you did on Unbelievable. We've been talking a little bit about it.
Okay.
And I will say this. I heard Dr. White say something I've never, ever heard him say, and I've been listening to his show for years. There were several times, actually, where he would play a clip of yours and he would say, I couldn't say it better myself.
Yeah, that was wonderful.
And I was like, wow, like Dr. White was speechless in that. So kudos to you, because that's quite the accomplishment.
Well, that was kind of him. I'm sure he could say so.
But then the third thing I wanted to get to was just, I think one thing we try to do on the show is encourage people to get off their couch, go across the street and share the gospel with their neighbor. I think too many people in the Christian church in the United States have just gotten lazy, and they've gotten afraid to offend people. And I think the one thing I got out of the conversation you had on Unbelievable is it seems that there's a fear that's really driving the evidentialists, and that they're afraid to offend the people that they're talking to. And that came out several times. Justin Bradley kept saying, well, you'd be patronizing. And he kept saying that. And then it kind of dawned on me that just bad theology is going to drive this bad apologetic, and that you're afraid to offend somebody. But you know what? The gospel is going to offend. And then, and with Reformed theological background, that's okay. You accept that. You're not afraid of that. You're going to go. You know the gospel is going to offend, but it doesn't matter because, you know, it's not up to us. It's not up to us becoming friends with somebody or saying something that's going to be pleasing to them. It's about getting them the gospel. And so that was just the biggest thing I got out of that show, and I was just hoping maybe you could just kind of jump off that a little bit, and I was curious what your thoughts were about that.
Yeah, thanks. I think one of the things I think I tried to do, I may be misremembering here, but one of the things I think I tried to do with Justin is to say, look, when you go out and talk to somebody about their need for Christ, is that an assertion, and is that going to be offensive? Well, according to Scripture, yeah, it might be. But the gospel doesn't only offend. Sometimes the Spirit works, and the gospel mm-hmm. becomes an aroma of life.
Yeah.
So the only way you're going to have one of those two reactions is if you communicate the truth. So I agree that we don't want to be unduly offensive. There's no reason, yeah. You know, one guy used to call this the burp effect. There's no reason to just burp the gospel in one's face so that you feel better and they're offended by mm-hmm. it. Because the gospel carries its own offense.
Right.
So we have to be, as Van Til liked to say, suaviter in modo, fortiter in re. What he meant in the Latin then is mild in manner, but strong in the matter. Mm. And so we need to be mild in manner as much as we're able to do that by the Spirit of God. We need to approach people with reverence, as 1 Peter tells us.
Mm-hmm.
But at some point, we have to say, listen, you, like me, are a sinner, and unless you repent, you will be eternally condemned, because our responsibility as image is to be like the one who is the original. And if that offends you, we can apologize, but it's the truth of the matter and it has mm-hmm. to be said.
Yeah, that's saying, you know, that sounds a lot like guys, sounds a lot like Jesus, sounds a lot like Paul, sounds a lot like Peter. And that's, I think that we have to capture that. See, the aim here is not to separate our apologetic from our evangelism or our apologetic from our theology. And that's just, I think, the difficulty we've had in being so ineffective, in a sense, is it's when we just do that and we separate our apologetic method or pursuit from our theology. And you can't take the, you can't have on two hats like that. It destroys the entire, even the reasoning as to why you're doing this. So, Dr. Oliphint, listen, last segment here. So quickly, the ninth tenet, you say the true covenantal knowledge of God in man, together with God's universal mercy, allows for persuasion in apologetics. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, again, I try to work this out in the book in some detail, but if we think about persuasion as attempting to make a connection between what I'm saying and what the other person knows or believes, okay, so we're trying to cross a bridge here. You said that there's an antithesis, those are in Adam and those are in Christ, and some people want to say, well, if the antithesis is that stark, then there's no way you can communicate to someone. It's just a shouting match. There's no communication available. And what we respond to that is, the way we respond to that is to say, if God has made himself known to every person, which he has, and that person has the truth, then we communicate the truth in such a way that it connects with the truth that God has already communicated by way of natural revelation. Now, the truth that we're communicating is the truth of the gospel. It's the truth of Scripture. So it's adding to what God has said in natural revelation, the truth that he has said in natural revelation. But the connection is the truth connection. So when we communicate truth, we are connecting with someone, and we know that that connection takes place because of what God has done and because of what God does in the communication of the truth. Again, it's back to Paul at Athens. The reason he uses those Greek poets in the quotation is because he knows by transplanting those and making the referent the true God that he's now connecting with that knowledge of God that they all have out there in the Athenian audience. He's connecting with that by virtue of what he says, and that hopefully is persuasive and will ultimately be persuasive if the Spirit of God uses it in that way.
Yeah, and I think it's important to note, I think what you've already pointed out, and that's just the point that when Paul does speak to them in Athens and he touches at those pagan poets and he brings them up and he's drawing out what you're displaying there, and he's touching that spot of the image of God in them, and he's using that now. Guys, what does he do from there? He says God commands men everywhere to repent. The gospel is not a request. It's not. It's just simply a suggestion. We play that quote from Dr. White in his debate on Calvinism at the very beginning of the show every single time, and that's that the gospel is a command to repent and believe. And you see that here in this apologetic method is how Paul is doing it and how Dr. Oliphint is really teaching us and instructing us how to do this. Okay, Dr. Oliphint, the tenth tenet here, and we actually did it, guys. We got through this. It says every fact and experience is what it is by virtue of the covenantal, all-controlling plan and purpose of God.
Right. Yeah, and again, that goes back to Scripture, doesn't it? We understand because of what God has said, not because we're smarter. We understand that every fact in the world, if it's going to be known truly for what it is, must be known as a fact that God has created, that he controls, and that he sustains. And if we don't know it in that way, then we know it in a rebellious way, and therefore we don't know it truly. We may be able to say certain things about it. We may be able to articulate, some superficial elements of it. But because we don't know it as God's fact in God's world, we don't know it truly. We also need to know that being confronted with that fact, we're confronted with God himself, and we're meant to submit to the fact as God's fact if we're going to know what it is. So that's a responsibility that every creature has made in the image of God, and that's why we make the point that for anyone to know themselves truly or to know the world truly, they have to know the true God by way of Jesus Christ. There's no other way to do it.
That's right. And you say here, and this is a great, I think, excellent quotation here from your book. It says, you say, the facts of the world display God's glory. Psalm 19:1, Romans 1:20. You say to take those facts for selfish use is to twist them and pervert them. This is culpable rebellion against God. And it takes place as those in Adam, quote, live and move and have our being in the triune God. Now, this I circled, highlighted, starred, like, this was, I love this, how you put this. You said, so in order for someone to understand one fact properly, that fact needs to be seen in the context of God's plan and purposes. The explanation of the fact itself is not sufficient unless and until the context and purpose of that fact is known and acknowledged. Now, here we go. This is, Luke, you're going to love this. I thought of you. I was like, you're going to like this. Mm. It says, for example, it is not enough simply to say that lions instinctively seek their prey because they are good hunters. Mm. The real story includes the fact that, and then Dr. Oliphint quotes Psalm 104, verse 21, the young lions roar for their prey, seeking their food from God. It is God who provides for the animals, not instinct. Mm. Excellent. Dr. Oliphint, we're out of time here, but I want to thank you for your graciousness towards us. And this book, which is such a blessing, Covenantal Apologetics, which people can get at WTSbooks.com.
Right. Well, it was great speaking to you guys. I appreciate the opportunity.
Absolutely. God bless you, brother. Thank you so much for all you do.
Uh-huh.
All right. Bye-bye. There you go, guys. So what'd you think?
Amazing.
That's awesome.
That's my boy right there. Did you guys all notice I was being kind of chill with him? Like, I'm not going like crazy. Like, you know, we weren't totally hyper. I didn't bring in Mortimer in this show.
Yeah. He already felt like he was on another planet.
Yeah, so. When he said that, I was like, oh, I'm going to keep it kind of chill for this episode.
Right? I didn't even play a single song.
We just started the episode off, and he was like, whoa, I feel like I'm on another planet. I'm like, I better keep it cool and chill for this episode. Guys. This is such a blessing. I know some of you guys are thinking right now, but yeah, Jeff, we didn't get into, like, example dialogue. And for that, I'm going to point you to any of the debate stuff we've done, any of the debate stuff that Dr. White has done, Greg Bonson. But at the same time, grab a copy of Covenantal Apologetics, Dr. Scott Oliphint, Oliphint. Get the book. Read it. Highlight it. You're going to be blessed. Luke Pearson.
Peace out.
I love you, dude, and love your beard.
Oh, thanks.
Smells delicious.
Cute.
Joy Temme.
Smells delicious.
You're awesome, too. I love you. This was an awesome episode. I love it. ApologyRadio.com.